Managing garden insects begins with a question: friend or foe? One of the most common questions that people ask entomologists about insects in the garden is, how do I kill it? However, many kinds of insects are actually helpful in the garden, and getting rid of them can lead to problems. Before you decide whether an insect is friend or foe, you must first answer the important question, what is it? The answer will tell you if it is a useful partner, a minor problem, or has the potential to become a serious problem. Once you know what it is, you can easily learn where it lives, how it lives, and if necessary, the options for effective management. The most sensible and intelligent option for managing insect pests is IPM, or Integrated Pest Management. IPM allows us to reduce reliance on one single method, like the use of pesticides, which is not always the most effective or environmentally friendly option. IPM allows us to make intelligent and thoughtful decisions about pest management. The steps of IPM are: monitor the garden, identify the problem pest, evaluate the situation, and predict the impact of the damage. Then make a decision about the best course of action and choose your control methods. Insects are the most diverse creatures in the world, and they also play many roles in the environment. At any given time, your home garden may have over 1,000 different insects. Some people consider insects as bugs or pests that are annoying and must be destroyed. It is not possible or even desirable to get rid of all the insects in the garden. Many insects are garden friends, others are foes, and a wise gardener knows the difference. Among the million or more insect species known on Earth, less than 3% cause problems to humankind and can be called pests. The other 97% are either harmless or actually beneficial. Let's start with some of the friends or the helpful insects in your garden. Most people are aware of beneficial insects that pollinate our crops and provide us with products like honey, beeswax, and silk. Insects also serve as food for birds, fish, and other animals, so they are important links in the food chain and for maintaining ecological balance. Through biological control, harmful insect populations can be reduced by using other live organisms, including insects. Sometimes natural enemies are mass-produced and released. However, in a landscape or home garden situation, it may be difficult to introduce, release, or retain commercially reared predator insects or parasitoids. So the best thing to do is conserve the existing natural enemies and avoid practices that harm them, such as unnecessary insecticide use. Predatory insects and other natural enemies can be attracted to your garden simply by providing food, water, and shelter through a diverse array of plant material. Planting a variety of pollen and nectar-bearing flowers can help conserve and increase the number of beneficial insects in your garden. Predatory insects are especially beneficial in the garden because they eat harmful insect pests. Predators are generally larger than their prey and faster. They have to capture and eat many individuals to complete their life cycle. Birds, amphibians, reptiles, fish, spiders, and insects are examples of predators that eat insects. Let's focus on some common predators. Spiders are some of the most common and important predators that can be found in a landscape or garden. Most are general predators that feed on a variety of prey. Spiders can be easily identified by their body shape and 8 legs. Although there are several mites that can cause significant damage to plants, there are also some predatory mites that prey on pest mites, as well as small insects like whiteflies and thrips. Predatory mites are similar to pest mites, with 8 legs and no antenna or wings, but they are often larger, more colorful, and move more rapidly than pest mites. Many of the true bugs, Heteroptera, are predators and prey on other smaller, soft-bodied insects like aphids, whiteflies, and even caterpillars. Assassin bugs are relatively large. Some can be identified by the wheel-like structure on their back and are often called wheel bugs because of this. Damsel bugs are smaller and have large eyes. Both of these hunters have a strong proboscis, long, flexible snout, that can pierce the exoskeleton of other insects. Other true bugs, such as shield bugs, also known as stink bugs, may be either hunters or plant eaters, depending on the species. Some insect-eating stink bugs, unlike their plant-feeding counterparts, have spine-like extensions on their shoulders, for example, the two-spined soldier bug. Plant bugs can also be pests. Once again, check the proboscis. The plant-eating bugs will have a delicate proboscis. Population size is another indicator of the insect's dining habits. Often 10 to 100 individuals of a plant-eating species will be found on a plant, whereas populations of a predatory species will be relatively low, with less than 10 individuals per plant. Green and brown lacewings are very common predators found in gardens and are fairly easy to identify because of their distinctive lace-like wing pattern. Adults feed on pollen and small, soft-bodied insects like aphids, lace bugs, and mites. Larvae are voracious predators with powerful sickle-shaped mandibles grasping appendages near the mouth. Lacewing eggs are an easy-to-identify treat in the garden. Each egg floats above the leaf surface, supported by a thread-like strand. This may serve to prevent cannibalism among the young larvae as they hatch. Praying mantids are also large and powerful predators. They use their strong front legs to capture and devour their prey. They are easily recognized and widely praised for their hunting prowess. However, they eat both friends and foes, including other praying mantids, so they may not be the most dependable hunter in the garden. Still, who can resist their charms? Several families of beetles are voracious predators both as larvae and as adults. Some of these may be common in your garden, such as ground beetles, tiger beetles, and rove beetles. These predators can be identified by their sickle-shaped crossing mandibles. Wasps, like paper wasps and yellow jackets, should be welcome in the garden because they do not attack plants, but instead protect them by feeding primarily on caterpillars. They have strong mandibles for chewing prey, as well as a proboscis, which they use to suck nectar from flowers. Please do not attempt to check their mouth parts. They are related to bees and may sometimes show aggressive behavior by stinging when disturbed. Give them plenty of space. Flies such as syrphid or flower flies and robber flies can be very important predators. Syrphid flies can be voracious feeders on aphids and will be attracted to pest populations even when they are low in number. They often mimic bees or wasps and appear to hover in flight like hummingbirds. Robber flies have heart-shaped heads with an indentation between the eyes and a bearded face. These flies may also mimic wasps and bees. They are often seen capturing prey in flight. You are probably familiar with parasites like ticks or fleas. They are generally much smaller than their hosts and live on or within the host for part or all of their life cycle. Generally, they don't kill their hosts. Insect parasitoids are different. They kill their hosts by eating them. Adult parasitoids often lay their eggs inside or on the host. The immature parasitoids hatch and consume their host during development. Many insect parasitoids are found in the order containing wasps, Hymenoptera. Some are very specific in prey selection. Others prey on a wide variety of pests. Parasitic wasps attack caterpillars and aphids. They lay eggs in the host, and when the larvae emerge, they consume the host. These wasps leave behind mummified hosts. The mummies have darkened shells with exit holes from which the adult parasitoid emerged. Sometimes the parasitoid will pupate on the host. Other species will pupate near the dead host. Parasitic wasps are also very effective against scale insects, and when large numbers of exit holes can be seen on scale insects, avoid spraying insecticides to conserve these natural enemies. As every gardener knows, not all garden insects are beneficial. Insects are often the cause of the unsightly damage seen on our plants. In many cases, the insect damage may weaken the plant and predispose it to diseases. Destructive insects can be divided into four basic categories based on the type of damage they cause to plants: chewing, discoloration, distortion, and dieback. Chewed, shredded, torn, and skeletonized leaves, flowers, buds, and fruits can be symptoms of insect damage on plants. This kind of damage is caused by insects with cutting and chewing mouthparts. These insects have powerful mandibles that cut up plant parts. Examples of such insects are caterpillars of butterflies and moths and larvae of sawflies, larvae and adults of beetles and grasshoppers. Discoloration of leaves by stippling, flecking, bleaching, or bronzing with no actual damage to the shape or size of leaves is often caused by insects with piercing and sucking mouthparts. This damage is caused when the insects insert their slender, needle-like mouthparts into the leaf tissue and draw out plant sap. In the process, they'll also damage the surrounding cells, which results in destruction of chlorophyll, leading to the leaf discoloration. The discoloration begins as small white flecks or stipples, and gradually the entire leaf may become chlorotic or bleached in appearance. Some insects that cause this type of damage are lace bugs, aphids, plant hoppers, white flies, and leaf hoppers. Mites and thrips are very small and may not be visible with the naked eye. Sometimes webbing may be seen in plants affected by mites. Thrips, adults, and juveniles can be identified under a microscope. Distortion of plant parts into abnormal shapes or structures can also be a sign of insect damage. For example, galls on leaves, flowers or stems, leaf curling or cupping, and abnormally twisted leaves or stems. This type of damage can be caused by different insects like thrips, aphids, larvae of some wasps and moths, and also gall mites. It is important to note that some plant diseases can also cause galls. Sometimes twigs, stems, or branches, or even the entire plant, appear to wilt and eventually die. This symptom, called dieback, can be caused by insects. These dead twigs and branches are retained on the plant. This damage is typical of scale insects because they are not mobile and severely deplete the branch or twig of plant sap. Some moth larvae and beetles that bore into stems can also cause this symptom. In addition to damage or symptoms, insect products often called signs, such as fecal spots, honeydew, frass, and catkins, are solid evidence of the presence and/or activity on the plant. These may not be directly harmful to the plant and often remain on the plant for long periods of time, even after the insect has left. Make sure there is an active infestation on the plant before considering the application of an insecticide. Sooty mold, a charcoal black fungus, grows on honeydew secreted by sap-feeding insects such as aphids, mealybugs, scales, and white flies. It is another common sign of insect activity. Though sooty mold appears to grow on the plants, it is not a plant disease and is a clear indication of an insect infestation. At times, sooty mold can also grow on other surfaces, like in this picture. You can see how the honeydew dripping from the tree above caused sooty mold on the wall and the road along the tree line. If the insect is controlled, the sooty mold will go away on its own. Chewing, distortion, discoloration, and dieback symptoms can be caused by a wide variety of insects, and often a single pest may cause different types of symptoms. Similar symptoms can be caused by plant disease or even abiotic causes, such as environmental stress, extreme heat, drought, cold injury, or chemicals. Once potential insect damage has been identified, the next step is to look for insects. Symptoms and signs alone do not warrant action. When you see any of these symptoms, look for insects. Carefully check both sides of the leaves and carefully study the stems. Look in the branch forks and all around the flowers. Insects can be very good at hiding. After locating suspected pests, the next step is to identify the host plant. Once you know the name of the plant, you can easily discover the common pests associated with it. At this stage in your diagnosis, your county extension agent will be a great resource. Each state has a pest control handbook that will suggest control measures if needed. Remember to consider the severity of the infestation and damage, plant species involved, and any evidence of predator or parasitoid activity before applying pesticides. We hope that this video will help you identify the insect friends and foes that you will commonly encounter in your gardens and landscapes. You will be amazed at just how astounding and fascinating the diverse world of garden insects can be. In fact, if you take the time to get to know them, you may find you enjoy your garden insects as much as the plants.